10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
Hey everybody, welcome. My name is Joe Buck. I'm so pleased that you're there for this On Fire book launch at that great theater at Chaminade. I'm a Country Day guy. Yes, I'm one of those. And my CDS for all you kids in the audience. And every time I drive by that theater, it is the envy of all of us ex-Country Day people. What a theater that is. This is a special day. It's a special day for John O'Leary. I know it's a special day for you. If you don't know my relationship with John, it really stems through my father. And as you become aware of this story, or maybe you are aware of this story, it really fills my heart every time I hear it. It makes me so proud. It makes me so proud of John. It makes me, in some ways, even more proud of my father with this great story, with this young boy who he didn't know before he walked in the door when John was fighting for his life. Sports can be a great healer, and it certainly is in this case. But I think what John has done with this message through this book is something that will resonate with anybody. Doesn't have to really be a sports fan. It has to be somebody who enjoys the spirit and the fight that was in John, continues in John, and the example that he sets for all of us every day that he wakes up. He's a special guy. He's very near and dear to my entire family, and it kills me that I'm not there today to introduce him in person. I am actually on spring break with my kids, but that's about all that would keep me away from Chaminade on this day. So without further ado, if you're not sleeping already, I ask that you wake yourselves and I think stand and applaud right out of the gate. I know you will when he's finished. Why not? Get up, stand up, applaud. Please welcome to the stage my good friend, a great friend to the Buck family and to the St. Louis community, and really, really a credit to his own family. Here he is, John O'Leary. John, all yours.
It was May 1987, late in May. I was in my room in the hospital, and down the hall, I heard my father's voice. He was talking to the staff. I understand later on he was pushing a wheelbarrow full of alcohol and lifesavers to the nurses who had worked so tirelessly and beautifully for the last 4.5 months to help save his son's life. I understand that some patients may have been harmed that night. If that's the case, my brother Jim will be available afterwards with his cards. So the champagne was handed out, but my dad eventually dropped off the wheelbarrow. He made his way into my room. I think it was room number 480. He bent down next to me. He looked me in the eyes, and my dad said, "I'll never forget it. You did it. You did it." And I'm sitting in that little wheelchair, and I'm thinking, he's right. And I could not have been farther from being accurate, because in looking back on my life and in working on my story, on writing that book and planning for tonight, I realized that I actually did very little by myself. I am the great recipient of profound love, and a theater at Chaminade with about 1,000 people on a Saturday night during spring break is pretty beautiful evidence of that. So what led up to this? It was a journey, no doubt, to get out of the hospital. The little boy came in all burnt up, needed several dozen surgeries, months of therapy, of course, bandage changes, which were grueling. The process to recover from those burns was nothing short of intense, but recover we did, and get out we did. And so eventually he switched out the champagne and the lifesavers for my 18-month-old sister, Laura. So she went into the wheelbarrow and orderly pushed me out. The nurses got hammered. I feel sorry for the other burn victims that were in the hospital after I left. And we went home. My mom now at the car, we had an old Woody station wagon. She helped me get out of the wheelchair, sat me in this thing, and a little bit of sunlight hit my right leg, just a tiny fraction of sunlight. And immediately they had to cover it up with a towel because the skin was so sensitive. And she looked me in the eyes, and then my mom looked at me and she said, "You did it. You did it. You're going home." And she was right. I did it. Except, again, it wasn't me. It was the entire staff. It was all the prayers. It was all the volunteers. It was all the men and women, the boys and girls who wrote those letters and encouraged the little guy on. We did it. I looked back and realized that. We had a party that day, I would imagine. And by the way, if you were there, make some noise right now. There were hundreds. We had a party. And people would come up one after another, and they kept looking at the little boy sitting there in his wheelchair with a big goofy grin on, each of them echoing the expression, "You did it. You did it, John." And that expression kept being echoed. About a month after homecoming, we took this thing downtown. And man, we had a party. Anytime you hang out with that dude, you have a party, okay? You don't just hang with Whitey Herzog, you party with Whitey Herzog. It's the first time I've ever seen a locker room of full-grown men naked. It's not something I would encourage any of you to go back to. We did it. We had a party. And then eventually the little guy leaves Busch Stadium, learns from the help of tutors who came to his little house while he was on morphine, while he was struggling, while he was in a bandage change type situation, and they served him until he could actually go back to school. I've never been more nervous, except maybe for tonight, than my first day back at grade school. My mom, again, drove me. She gets me out of the car, picks me up essentially, puts me into my wheelchair. She rolls me in. I haven't been at school in like 13 months. I have no idea what these kids are gonna think about me. I've changed a little bit. As soon as she rolls me in, the classmates, maybe 25 of them or so, jumped to their feet and ran over to the little guy pictured behind me tonight. We did it. We did it. Their love, I think, is in no small part why I learned again to have confidence in myself and learned again to smile and again recapture my humor. Never really learned how to recapture my academic prowess, but I'm still, there's hope. I believe in hope. Through their love and their guidance and all the teachers and all the support, again, this little boy goes on through grade school at St. Clement's into high school. Joe Buck answered the question, I'll answer mine, DeSmet Jesuit, so that's where I went to high school. Woo, thank you. Thank you, Jim. It was one of us out of 1,000, that's not bad. Those who did not make it in DeSmet went to Chaminade or SLU, that's okay. Four years at DeSmet, had a blast. Guys from all over the St. Louis area who had never heard of this little guy or seen this young boy never once questioned him. And that means a great deal when you are at a formative time in your life to be accepted. So I was accepted. I was well-loved in high school as well. 4 years at DeSmet, followed by 9 years at St. Louis U. Too close to home for some of us, I would imagine, but this is about our lifestyle back then. But they were great. My friends, I know many of them are here tonight, were outstanding and instrumental beacons in the man that I would become. It led through 4 years of college, actually, into graduation. Near the end of my time at St. Louis University, I had a chance encounter with a brunette. The most attractive lady, brunette, of any skin color in this room tonight. Her name is Elizabeth Grace. We'll come back to her later on. But that's my bride, Beth. Woo! That's our family picture recently. We did it. And we keep doing it. It's going to be a breakout later on. If you want to stick around, I'll talk about this picture in greater detail. After college, even before these little ones showed up, and I'll come back to Jack, Patrick, Henry, and Grace here in a moment, but before they showed up, their daddy was in real estate, single-handedly sending John Jackson's kids through school. Okay? So I would buy, with his help, these old beat-up houses. They're lovely. And then, through the work of my friend like Harold and others, we would renovate these things and slowly bring them back to life. And I loved it. We did it. It was the kind of thing I could never have done on my own, but collectively with a great team and a great family and a great support system, we could. And we did. And we had a blast doing that for about a decade. And that all changed after my mom and dad came up with this crazy idea to write a book. A book about a guy who had never told anybody really in the world how he was burned. And they put my picture on the front of it. It's an unauthorized biography of my life, if you'd like to check it out. It's available on the book tables. I think it's $15 tonight. They'll sign it for you. And it changed my life. You ever have that moment in your own experience where one thing comes along that you were not expecting, for good or for bad, and then everything after that is different? It will never again go back to how it was before. That's what Overwhelming Odds did for me. It changed the way I felt about the fire, because for the first time I realized we did it. I realized I was not a victim to it, but that this tragedy was actually a triumphant experience that we collectively, that God blessed, and that this little boy endured. We did this. It was a great read. It changed my life. It changed the way I looked in the mirror, and then eventually changed what I did for a living. 3 months or so after my mom and dad wrote their book, I'm working with my main man, Harold, in front of a pickup truck, and I get a call. It's from a lady who has 3 Girl Scouts she's responsible for. And she asked me, Mr. John, if I would be willing to share my story with her troop. I had never told anybody how I was burned. My friends who are sitting here today, they're learning for the first time, I think, tonight that I was burned, okay? So I never told anybody that I was burned. I'm not a speaker. In college at St. Louis U, we took a class called Business Speaking. I took it second semester senior year because I was terrified of public speaking. I barely passed. So when they called, this was a challenge. But in life, I've always learned, if you are bold enough and brave enough and faithful enough to say yes, just say yes. Amazing things frequently result. Just being open to saying yes. So I said yes to 3 Girl Scouts. I practiced a talk for more than 50 hours for 3 Girl Scouts. Never once looked up at those little monsters. Kept my eye down the entire time. And there's my first talk right there. Not even a payment of Samoas. Nothing. Nothing. They gave me nothing. Except the experience of saying, there's my first talk. I was able to say yes to something bigger than myself, which is really important. Which meant a few months later, when I'm at work, my real job, I got another phone call, this time from a Rotarian, and he said, would you speak at my club? Yes. And then it happened again. Yes. And then again. 3 times that first year, 8 times the second. We have had the honor, and I say we on purpose, we've had the honor of sharing this talk more than 1,500 times in all 50 states all around the world these days. It's something that we did, and I could have never done by myself, ever. There are some ladies here, and if I don't mention them right now, I may forget later on with the energy I'm feeling right now, but Abby and Sandy and Deanna, if you are in the room right now, you got to stand and be recognized briefly. There's Abby, Sandy, and Deanna. You were told that you would be home by midnight tonight. Otherwise, I would go into great detail on all 3 of these ladies and Molly and the other leaders who came before them. This night does not happen without them. None of what we do professionally happens without them. I'm acutely aware of it every day. It grounds me and humbles me and blesses me. So, ladies, thank you for your work and your friendship. We're here because of you, so I'm grateful. But that's not the end of the story. The gifts keep showing up. If you are willing to say yes, if you are bold enough in life just to say, yeah, you know, I'll be open to it. So I was open to writing a story about my life. It's called On Fire. You may have heard of it. You may have it in your possession tonight. Yes, I'll write it. Yes, we'll send it up to publishers. Yes, we'll be rejected a lot of times before. Finally, yes, we figure out what the story's really about. And it's actually not about the author. It's about all the love that went into allowing this little boy, and then this young man, and then this older fella, and then this business owner, and then this speaker, and then this father to show up in life. It's about you. So tonight, you may not know it yet, but we're here to celebrate you. So I'm nervous. I'm fired up about celebrating you. And I'm also extremely excited that other people in the marketplace get to read about you. I'm not the only one that knows your story anymore. These four buyers at Barnes & Noble also know your story. I'm not sure any of them paid for it. Grace is two-fisting this thing. And look at this. Double fist, baby. But they're not the only ones reading it either. It came out on Tuesday this week at midnight. And immediately, it raced through the levels at Amazon. When I took this picture, the number one new release last week. Was a little book from St. Louis, Missouri, written by a somewhat introverted kid who never knew a story until his mom and dad and so many others said it's worthy. Maybe it's time that you embrace it too. Number one, that's not something I could have done. We did it again. We have done it again and again and again, and I'm grateful and I'm humbled and I'm excited to be with you tonight. But some of you are probably wondering, where did it all begin? How did we really all end up here tonight? How did we all get here? So I'm going to take you back, share a little bit of my story, share with you some of the leaders and inspirations in my life. And a little while later, I'll take the questions that you may have, whatever questions. So get ready to ask any questions that might be on your mind. I'll wrap up with maybe a song, maybe a story, and then we'll go up and have some fun outside. So here we go. When I was 9, I saw little boys in my neighborhood playing with fire and gasoline. And what these little men would do, they were like 11, they would sprinkle some gasoline on a sidewalk, they would strike a match, stand back about 2 feet for safety. Very risk-averse West County kids. Throw the match on top, and whoop, the gasoline would spark. And when you are 9 and you are a male, this is awesome. Because you are watching liquid turn to fire, and these are boys you respect. They're 11. You're 9. They have peach fuzz. You don't. You still don't. And you're thinking, if they can do this and get away with it, what's the next line? So can I. Those are beautiful words when we have the right leaders out in front. But when we don't, or when we're following the wrong advice, it can be dangerous. So that weekend, mom and dad are gone. The house is mine. You know where I'm going. Many of you live through this. Many of you are neighbors to this. I walked into the garage, came over to a 5-gallon can of gasoline, bent down next to it. The plan was to pour a tiny bit of gasoline on top. Before the liquid even came out, my friends, what shows up first? The fumes. The vapor. The invisible stuff. This is really important. In life, it's seldom what you see coming that burns you. This is not a fire story anymore. This is about relationships, and this is about your health. This is about your faith life. It's about our country. It's about our finances. It's very seldom what you see coming. It's the fumes. It's the stuff we're just too busy and preoccupied to think about. That's the stuff that always brings us down to our knees, blows us back. That day what got me, and I think every day what gets us, are those darn fumes. Came out of that can for me, big explosion, picked me up, and launched me 20 feet against the far side of the garage. When we were little, we were all taught and trained what to do when we're on fire. What are we supposed to do when we're on fire? Good. What do you actually do when you're on fire? Good, that's right, run. because we train up here. Marriage is easy up here. Work is easy up here. Faith life is easy up here. Eating right is easy up here. The challenge is we live and we lead and we serve and ultimately impact from a much more sacred source. So that day when life blew up on me, it wasn't my head that I turned to. It was fear. I got scared. I took off running on fire through those flames, came through the flames, opened up a little garage door, walked up two steps, and now I'm in my mom and dad's house, covered in gasoline, flames leaping 3 feet off of my body. And I'm scared, so I just kept running. I'm on fire. I just kept running. Through the kitchen, the family room, into the front of the house, stood eventually on top of this rug, just screaming and burning and begging and praying for a hero. God, I will take anybody. I'll take anybody. Anybody else? You ever had one of those prayers? Not this guy. And yet, Jim, who is here with us tonight, we'll talk about him a little bit in a moment. This is his moment to change and to shine, to become a better version of himself, which is all of our invitations every day. To become a better version of yourself, just a little bit better today than yesterday. This is his moment to change, to shine. What Jim does is he picks up a rug. He runs over to me. The flames are leaping 3 feet off of my body. And this 17-year-old boy who was sleeping in the basement, doesn't really know what's going on, has this rug in tow, and he swings down left, and then right, and then he drops the rug, and he pulls back. Why do you think he dropped the rug? Caught fire. Have you ever touched anything hot? Two people out of 1,000. Is the mic still on? You've never touched a curling iron. Coffee. Emo's pizza before it cools. When we touch something hot, what do we naturally do? What do we say? What do you really say? We drop it. I don't care what you say. Talk is cheap if it's not backed up with action that echoes it. I don't remember what Jim said. Maybe he said, ouch. Maybe not. I remember what the guy in the red sweater up there did. He dropped the rug. He turned his back. I'll never forget it. And then I remember what Jim did next. It's to realize it's not about me. Which was the discovery I finally had in working on my book. It's not about me, actually. Which is a freeing experience to have in our lives. Because then we can stand up and do the next best thing, even if it burns a little bit. For Jim, that day, as a 17-year-old, self-centered, punk brother, he changed and shined. Picked back up that rug, swang down into those flames a third time, a fourth time, a fifth time for 2.5 minutes, burning himself, saving my life. 1987, the lifesaver of the year for the state of Missouri was a 17-year-old boy named Jim O'Leary that I would like to stand up right now and be recognized. Jim became my hero that day and has remained in that high status of mine ever since. I mean, he saved my life. I'll never forget it, and I'll always be grateful for it. So I don't say it enough, but it is true. I love my brother. I'm grateful for what he did. And he will have a table in the back if you've been injured, if your neck hurts. just check it out. Kick the tire. See what you think about Jim. But as good as Jim is, he can't do that by himself either. He had firefighters there that morning. They showed up. These heroes that we all celebrate on TV, these big, tough guys. So these two firefighters showed up. They were there on the scene almost immediately. We happened to grab their pictures. I want to show you them. Okay, you ready for the first tough guy? Here he is. Not that. There he is. Who are you expecting? it's my sister Amy, and she's 11, and we had a fight the night before, but she's scared that day because her little brother's in the front yard, and he's bent over, and his clothes and skin are burnt off, and this little girl walks over to him. She puts her arms around me. She pulls me close, and the first thing my sister Amy said, John, it's okay. It's okay. Have faith and fight. It's okay. And I just remember knowing she was wrong. Because it's not okay. I mean, have you seen this? It's not all right. The house is burning. It's not okay. And I remember saying to her, it's not all right, Amy. Go back into the house. I'm not going to make it anyway. I want you to get me a knife. Come on back out here. And just kill me. It's not okay. That's me. That's I. But we were bigger than that. And this little girl pulls me even closer and she says back to me, John, by the way, this is a word you can use if I go over my time. John, shut up. It's okay. Have faith and fight. The best is yet to come. My sister Amy. And before we move into who else is listening to the conversation, I'm going to demand that my sister Amy stands up too. So Amy, stand up. She sees my dad later on in the emergency room, and she says to him, Daddy, John felt so hot that as I was holding on to him, I was certain that I was burning my arms through my nightgown. And then she said, but Daddy, I never let go. That's not I. Again, that is we. And overhearing the exchange in the front yard, not just my brother Jim, my sister Amy, and me, there was one more tough guy. Here he is. He's a she, she's 7. She is Susan, who's also here with us tonight. Susan does not really like me back then. Okay, I'm her older brother. It's the way big families operate. So that day, when I'm asking for the knife, I don't need to ask her twice. Okay? It's a true story. She goes into the house. The house is on fire. She crawls through the front hall, through the family room. Many of you have been in that house. Crawls all the way back into the kitchen, opens up the drawer, she grabs it, and then she races back outside. I will never forget being held in the front yard in love. And then she comes out. Okay. Love. Not the opposite of love. It's pictured here. She comes over to me, stands about 2 feet away from me. She's panting. Her cheeks are full. There's soot on it. Tears going over those big fat cheeks. She pauses for like 3 seconds. And then this little girl throws a cup of water right at my face. Man, I want to die. And in a room of 1,000, I know some of us can relate to that. I went out. And this little girl just risked her life for mine. And after she does that the first time, my friends, tonight, 1,000 strong in this theater, what do you think this little girl goes and does? Gets another. Because that's, of course, what you do if life's really not about you. You risk everything to go back into a burning house for somebody else. She does that a second time, throws it on my face, and then she turns and she goes right back in. I think it's a miracle that she goes into a burning house 3 times for 3 cups of water, risking her life each time for mine. So before we move on to the next slide, I need to recognize one of the great heroes of my story and in my life today, my little sister, Susan O'Leary. Susan, stand up. And while the lights are on, because I'm not going to speak directly to her or her incredible vocal ability, is my oldest sister, Katie, who is also with us tonight. So Katie, would you stand up? You are a delight and one of the heroes of my story. And then my little sister, Laura, who was pushed up in a wheelbarrow years and years ago, today is rocking her own child. She had a baby about a week ago, so she's at home right now. But it takes a village. You can't do life very well by yourself. And yet, collectively, we can do some miraculous things when we have a faith in something in God and for us in our Christian walk in Christ, bigger than ourselves. And all three of these girls that day and every day since have lived it out. This is my sister with an extreme zoom in. And this is the brother that they were all risking their life for. One moment, I'm a perfectly happy, healthy. I'm going to zoom in so you ladies and gentlemen who got here a little bit late can see it as well. Just candidly, extremely good looking. Bangs like that. Okay. That is either a laser level. Or what else might it be? It's a freaking bowl cut. That's right. And that little white thing you see under my chin, what's that called? It's not a turtleneck. It's a freaking dickie. Yes. Some of the young kids don't even know what a freaking dickie is, so lean over and whisper it to them. They're like, I didn't know it was that kind of story. It is. A dickie is like a napkin you wear around your neck. It's a horrible device. But if you look closely, and I'm being serious, this kid is well loved. Those of you who know our family, we're not perfect. But my mom and dad were shining examples of what love looks like. My dad was home for dinner every night. My mom stayed home. We had an incredible upbringing. We had incredible grandparents. My grandmother, who is 96, 99, I just found out. No, she's 94. She is with us tonight, and she's the best-looking lady in the house, so would you turn on the lights, and I'm going to have my grandma stand up. So she's part of the story, and her hero husband who fought in World War II is part of the story. It takes everybody to be part of the story. So we're blessed. One moment, this is my life, though, and then everything, it seems like the blessings fade. It all just kind of disappeared in the flash of an explosion. The next picture will be hard to look at. It's the only really hard one tonight. So if you have children or you just don't want to see it yourself, you may want to shut your eyes for a moment. But I found myself as a child on my back, with burns on 100% of my body. 87% are third degree. I'm dying. Okay, there's just no getting around it. I am absolutely dying. I'm laying there in this bed, looking up at the lights. And as a child, 9, St. Louis, Missouri, all I could think was, oh my gosh, one thought. My dad is going to freaking kill me. I just blew up his house. I'm a goner. And this nurse does me no favor. She brings my dad back to where I'm laying. He pulls back the curtain. The old guy walks in, points down, and then he lays in. You guys, you ladies, ever been in trouble? Okay, a few of us. Have you noticed if you do these, kind of cross your arms, it's not so bad. So my heart is cold to it, Dad. I'm ready for you. My armor is up. The shield is in front of me. He walks over. The guy points down, and then he says very firmly to me, but again, I'm ready for it. John, look at me when I'm talking to you. I have never been so proud of anybody in my entire life. And my little buddy, today, I'm just proud to be your dad. And then my mean dad said, I love you. I love you. I love you. So I'm laying there in the bed. I'm hearing all of this, trying to make sense out of it. So I shut my eyes again. And for me at 9, the rationale was this. Oh my gosh. Nobody told my dad what happened. And then the next thought is, man, I wonder if I can get away with it. You know, maybe old Jimmy's out there painting the garage doors right now. I mean, who knows? For the men in the room, men, brothers, do you think my dad knew what happened? Yes or no? Hey, boys, yes or no?
Yes.
In a marketplace of no's, and fear. Watch the debates if you don't believe me. Let your yes and let your light and let your faith be heard loud and clear, guys. Yeah, dad knows. Dad's irate. He's curious. He's furious. He's got a lot of anxiety all the way up until the moment when he pulls back the curtain and he realizes specifically in front of him what matters. And he leaves behind all the fear. He faithfully steps forward in love. Dad changed and I followed. And before I talk at all about my mom, I want to recognize one of the great heroes in my life who is with us in the first row tonight, my dad, Denny O'Leary. So, Denny, stand up carefully. Love. He used it that day. He's used it over the 29 years since. From a wheelchair lately with Parkinson's, struggling mightily physically, and yet that goofy grin that was just on his face is always on his face. It's a choice. You don't have to make it. We can go through life as miserable as we choose. Dad just doesn't want to play that game. He's not a victim to Parkinson's. He's a victor over it, and he knows ultimately where this game ends up. So he's a delight. He's my hero. I love him. I loved him then. I love him now. And I love his wife, my mom, Susan. I'm from St. Louis County. Some folks who came from other parts of the region, you realize that it can be a little strange out there, especially in the mid-80s. My mom and dad back in 87 thought it was cool to not only wear the exact same shirt, but also, curiously, to cut their hair in the exact same... This is awkward, but if this is a question on your mind or heart and you don't want to ask during the Q&A, I'll answer for you right now. Okay, that is my mama on your left. So she walks into the room. She takes my right hand. The hand's still warm. It's a mess. This is her baby. We saw a slide taken 30 years ago of a man, and you know he's got a family and life is good. She's walking into a train wreck, and she takes my right hand, pats my bald head, and she leads with love. Here's what she says. I love you. And so I say back to my mom, Mama, knock it off with the love. Am I going to die? Have you ever asked a question where you don't want the honest answer? But I want hope. I want hope. I want to be told somebody's going to make America great again. That's what I need to hear. Someone's going to do this crap for me. I need it so bad. I want hope. I want her to say, baby, come here, baby. What are you talking about? We're going to get you out of here today. We'll swing by Steak and Shake, honey. I want the milkshake promise. And Mom gave me truth, which you don't hear a whole lot in debates, actually. From either party, I don't care what side of the party you sit on. She get led with truth, which is bold. It takes courage. It takes an awful lot of love, but it changes lives, starting with her own. She asked me a question that was a mighty inflection point for me. My hand in hers, she looked into my eyes, and this is what she asked. Baby, do you want to die? It's your choice. This is not mine. That lady... on your left, is either extraordinarily cold-hearted, that's my vote, or she is extraordinary. So who thinks she's cold-hearted? Okay. Awkward, awkward. Who thinks she's extraordinary? Woo! I do too. And I looked up at my mom and I said to her, Mom, I do not want to die. And her response was, good, then look at me. Take the hand of God, you walk the journey with him, and you fight like you have never fought before. She said, your daddy and I will be with you every step along the journey, baby, but you must fight. It's your fight now. Own it. When you sat down and Mike Mattingly, who, by the way, rocked, would you give him a big hand? After he turned off his guitar, he walked off the stage. There was a quote from Ciroc. it may have sounded a lot like this. Set before you, John, and 1,000 friends, are fire and water. To whatever you choose, stretch out your hand. Before everyone, every day, are life and death. Whichever they choose will be given to them. Bless you. Whichever we choose every day. Our thoughts matter. Free will is a beautiful thing, but you got to own it. And that day, my mom made me own my choice in this problem, also in the solution. I said to her, I don't want to die. You heard that. She told me to fight, and we have been fighting every day since. It is a street fight some days, and what we have found is it is completely worth it. Now, later on tonight, you're going to walk through these two exits. And you're going to call a friend. You're going to shoot off a text. You're going to post on Facebook. Maybe someone's going to ask you how tonight went. When they ask you, do not say back to them, no. Okay. Hey, I heard you went to that O'Leary deal. How was it? No. Cross it off, Fagan. That is not the main takeaway, okay? No. What we get to do in a marketplace that is out there being busy, driven by fear, is to remind them there's a separate story. That they get to they don't have to choose it, but they get to choose it. Free will. Fire and water. Life and death. Your choice, not mine. My mom put it in front of me, and we've been choosing it every day. Not a run away from death, but a race toward life. So this is our question tonight. My friends, I'll read it to you. Do you want to live, yes or no?
Yes.
Me too. I'm all in. Every day, I am all in. It's a choice we make, and it's a choice, candidly, that we really can't do well by ourselves. We need our community. We need one another. We need the theater. We need everybody. I had an incredible team that made the journey forward from that date, January 17th, a possibility. We all went to church back then at St. Clement's, which I would bet represents heavily tonight. St. Clement's, if you are here, would you make some noise for us tonight? We had family, we had friends, we had donors, we had strangers, we had people writing letters all over the world, people planting trees in Israel. Popes writing letters, President Reagan writing the letter. The community got behind it. The staff, nurses, technicians, doctors. I won't put any of them tonight on the spot, but without their care, there is no way I'm with you tonight. So to my nurses and my therapists and my technicians and my janitors and my doctors, thank you. I'm here because of you and your great love, so thank you for that. But that's not enough either. Now you need volunteers. You need servants. After I had a series of surgeries, they had to eventually flip me from my back onto my stomach, and I spent 3 weeks or so on my tummy, tied down to the bed, looking down through a hole in the bed. 3 weeks. So I'm bored. It's a little bit depressing. It's kind of miserable. And into this room comes a St. Louis Blue 26-year-old hockey player named Gino Cavallini. I love hockey. So when he walks in, I'm blown away. I remember the first time he came in, my mom wanted to see if I wanted to meet a guy named Gino Cavatelli. No, not Gino Cavatelli. No, but Gino Cavallini, I'll take some of that. So Gino comes in. He's 26. I don't know what you were doing at 26. I wasn't visiting little burn kids. He gets down on his knees. He looks up and he says, "How you doing, superstar?" And I say, "Awesome." He says, "Tell you what, superstar, and tonight I'm going to do something cool for you. I'm going to score you a goal." Is it easy to score in hockey?
No.
In particular, apparently, if you play for the St. Louis Blues. Okay. One of those deals. So this guy's not going to score. So I'm 9. I know that. I follow hockey. Gino's not going to score. So I say back to him, "Gino, do us both a favor, man. Get in a fight instead." And this awesome young man, still staying humble, still looking up through the hole, says to me, "Tell you what, superstar, tonight, if I don't score you a goal, I promise you, I'll get in a fight." True story. So my mom and dad are in the room that night. We're listening to the game. The first period comes, and about 9 minutes in, Gino Cavallini keeps the promise. Kept the promise. Gets in a brawl, man. It was awesome. Kept the promise. And we kept listening to the game. This is a true story. Third period against the hated Red Wings. Boo. Gino Cavallini, who's really not known as a goal scorer back in the mid-80s, keeps the original promise. And scores what turns out to be the game winner. I learned later on that this big, tough Canadian hockey player started crying on the ice. Is he crying because he scored a goal to make it 3-2? Like, he's just fired up, we may win this thing. Is that what it is? No. There was something worthy. There was mission. There was meaning in what he was doing. And so he wept, and I think that's a sign of great strength. And then that night, they went out and partied. I don't know if you know this about hockey players. They have a tendency to like to celebrate victories and defeats. They're not particular. They'll celebrate either one, and they typically celebrate at bars. That night, Gino Cavallini, 24 of his teammates, and a 7-foot blue bunny that he brought celebrated with a whole bunch of Emo's pizza, a whole bunch of soda, and a 9-year-old little boy on his belly, stretched out on the bed, named John O'Leary. They partied until 2:30 in the morning. The last guy out of the room, hold your applause just for a moment, the last guy out of the room is Gino Cavallini. He gets down, he looks up, he's scrubbed up, he's wearing yellow and the mask and the gloves and the booties. He looks up and he says, "How you doing now, superstar?" What do you think my response was?
Awesome.
Awesome. That's not I. That's we. That's Gino. That's his teammates that were supporting him that day. That's we. It's always that. It's the we. It's that piece. I haven't seen Gino in a long time. I haven't heard about Gino in a long time. But recently I sat on a plane with a guy who knew Paul Cavallini. Do you remember the name Paul Cavallini? So this guy, while I'm sitting next to him, says, "Oh, I bet Gino would love to hear from you. Let me get his number from Paul." So Paul texts the number back. Do you ever get like that number where you're supposed to call someone but you're too nervous so you don't do it? Dude, it's been like 29 years, so I don't do it. Until later on that evening, my wife is running an errand. I'm getting dinner on, and while the water is boiling, I send a quick text to Gino Cavallini. And I took a picture of it just because I know some of you are like, this is such a bunch of bull. This dude will do anything to sell books, okay? Anything. Here's what the text said. "Gino, it's John O'Leary, the burned up 9-year-old kid you visited 30 years ago in a hospital bed in St. Louis. Man, I am doing great today, and I hope you are too. Been traveling around the world sharing my story over the last few years. You, Gino, are certainly a big part of it. Let's find some time to grab coffee sometimes in the next few weeks. I'll be looking forward to it. Thanks, man. Shoot me some dates." I had no idea where the dude lived. I knew he wasn't in St. Louis anymore. Less than 60 seconds after I hit send, my phone rings. You ever look down at a phone and you're like, should I get it? Send it to voicemail? I pick up, it's Gino, and he says, "God, man, what you been up to? Been almost 30 years. So we talked for a while, and then while we were on the phone, we're exchanging some messages back and forth. I wanted to show my beautiful 4 babies and my wife, so I sent that over. He sent me a picture of him recently. Gino's kind of a badass, and he's my friend, so don't mess with me, okay? I have a strong friend, and he'll get my back, trust me. I learned he shaved his head because he has a heart for other people that are enduring cancer. And so he shaved his head to say, you know what, you're not in this by yourself. I'm going to shave my head too. So that's why he's bald in that picture. Apparently, Gino's got a full head of hair. He lives in Chicago. I invited him to be here today, but he was supposed to be in Minneapolis. Which is why it is even cooler that instead of being in Minneapolis, he finds himself today in St. Louis, Missouri at Chaminade Theater. So my friends, give a big hand to one of the celebrities of my story, Gino Cavallini. Come on up here, man. Pass out the branded Kleenexes. Gino Cavallini from Chicago, Illinois today, born in Toronto, decides to serve a burnt up 9-year-old child that he had never met. So Gino, in front of our friends, the we, tell us about how you even learned of this little boy's story.
Is this on? Is on now?
You're hot, man.
I'm hot.
And humble.
I guess it was Mr. Shanahan, who owned the team at the time, knew that I would try to get out to see kids, not just burn victims, but, you know, I had a lot of time on my hand, and I felt like not an obligation, but, you know, coming from an immigrant family, knew I was, we're, my brother and I were fortunate to be in the position we were in, and if there was an opportunity that we could help and make a difference in someone's life, that we could, and they knew I did this, and they just made a call and showed up to see this guy. Jeez.
Do you remember the visit when you and I, you got down on your knees, you had like a 36-ounce soda that was illegal back then. So Gino was feeding me soda through a straw into the hole in the bed. Do you remember that visit?
I remember looking, laying on the floor, being down on the floor, looking up at you and just, you know, like everyone else, wishing you on, you know, that you come through what you had to do.
So for most of us, when we do something generous one time, we kind of high-five ourselves or pat ourselves on the back on the way out. Why'd you come back again and again and again, and not just for little John, but for all the kids that you served?
Oh, because I could make a difference, maybe. You know, deep down, maybe little encouragement, you know, could go a lot further because of who I was. And I felt, you know, and I'll, you know, It's hard to explain. It's just something that my brother and I always did, and we enjoyed it, and we would, you know, continue doing it.
Do you remember scoring the goal?
I remember that night knowing, okay, I got a problem. Because I didn't necessarily know how much ice time I would get, who I would be playing with, and I knew that I could keep part of the promise and get it over with right away by getting in the fight. So once I had the fight, there was a lot less pressure on me once I got in the fight. But I had teammates that, you know, knew what was going on, and, you know, they were good teammates. We were a team, and, you know, I was the one that was coming in, but they were all there with me.
Gino, after he scored, he started crying, but I learned also later on that the four hockey mates, there's five out there at the time, all five guys were crying together. So when Gino says we had good teammates, this was not him twirling his way down the ice by himself. These guys were trying their very best to make sure the promise was kept. Yep. And that night they partied. Do you remember the celebration?
I don't know if it was that. I mean, we won, so that it wasn't much different than if we had lost. But we certainly had fun.
Tell us what you're doing today.
I with a partner of mine, we run a non-for-profit hockey organization in Chicago, and we're one of the top clubs in the country, and we help young athletes realize their dreams. We move on kids to college every year out of our club. Chicago Mission.
What would you say to the helicopter parents who are expecting they have the next Gino Cavallini in the back of their minivan?
You never know. You don't know who it is, but you know, as long as they love doing what they're doing, we encourage them, and you know, we try to get them in front of who they need to get in front of and move them on.
My final question is, what would you say to young athletes out there today, that whether they play with the Blues or they're minor league or they're with the Cardinals, what might be your challenge to these guys when they're not playing in the game?
Just to remember, you know, where they came from, and, you know, everyone needed some help along the way, and to not forget who you are and, you know, give back.
So, Gino, that night he scored, he came with me to the hospital. He brought 24 of his best friends, a 7-foot bunny, and one stick signed by all the guys. He has not seen this stick in 29 years.
Now I realize why I never used to score.
This is the stick that Gino scored with. Gino is going to be hanging out with us tonight after our celebration. Do me a huge favor, run over to him, give him the biggest St. Louis hug for not what he did on the ice, which was beautiful, but for the role model he is off the ice. So my friends, one more time, give Gino Cavallini a big hand.
Oh, that's huge.
Yeah. We found Gino. So here's, we're going to take like a momentary pause. I realize this has been extraordinarily emotional. And I want to make sure that as the night progresses, it's not about John O'Leary or Gino Cavallini for that matter, but about you and about the Ginos in your life and about the moms and dads in your life and about the little ones in your life and about the individuals who made a big difference for you in your life. Because we all have a Gino. And for many of us, it's been 29 years since we've called and said thank you. So right now, I want to encourage you to think back in your lives on some of those Ginos for you and someone that maybe you could reach out to say thank you and to help make it even a little bit more emotional, to fill the silence just a little bit. I'm going to sit down at this big, large, grand piano and play a song. When I got burned, the great blessing for me was I would never have to take piano lessons again. And about 6 months in, my dream was working just fine. But then the doorbell rang. The lady walked in, and my mom said, "She's here for you." I didn't really have fingers. I still had bandages. I'm still in a wheelchair. They rolled me up to this old piano, and this lady taught me how to play the piano again. And the very first song that I relearned was a song that I'd like to play for you tonight. I seldom play the piano live unless I'm at my house and I've had a Budweiser or two. I seldom play the piano, and I've never played the song live, but I want you guys and you ladies, my friends, be reminded of the Ginos in your life. So maybe this song will spark that memory for you. Thank you. it's a player's piano. It was just all an act. So we're at the part of the program, for those of you loving the timeline, where we're going to turn the lights on just a little bit brighter, and I would love to answer any questions that may be on your heart. We're going to spend about a little bit of time taking questions from you, and I promise you to answer them as honestly and vulnerably as I possibly can. So if you have any questions right now, I'd like you to open up your heart, raise your hands. We got a couple microphones running around. By the way, when you stand, here's what we're going to do. You're going to take the microphone, you're going to introduce yourself, in this case, nice, as Mary, and then the rest of us are going to give Mary a big, huge welcome. So give Mary a big, huge welcome.
John, I am very emotional tonight because there was a time that I never could have believed that this would come to pass. And I saw Gino with your mom a little bit ago, and I'm going to ask you if you remember the day that you came home and there was a great big poster on your house that said, Gino is wonderful, Ozzy is too, but John O'Leary, my hero, is you.
Right. I do remember that, and I'm grateful.
Do you remember?
Yes.
This is just such a special night, and I thank God for the gift that you are to everybody in this auditorium.
Thank you.
I was truly proud to write that poem, and to this day, you are my hero and always will be. God bless you.
Thank you. Volunteered on here, would you stand up, tell us your name, and we're going to give you a big round of ovation. Your name first?
Yes, my name is Maria.
Big hand.
And I'm just so thankful to be here tonight. You've always been my hero. I've known about you for so long time ago when I worked at the school. Read your story. I was just overwhelmed with happiness, encouragement, what example you are to so many. But I don't know if you remember how you helped me with my book. You were my mentor. This is so emotionally, but yet full of happiness. You were my mentor, and I'm always going to honor you as my hero. How you encouraged me, how you gave me hope to make this dream come true with my book, to carry my son's work alive, all because of you. You're the best.
Thank you. You know, there's an old expression, everyone has a story. It's just generally not the story we're telling the world. And Maria has an incredible story of remarkable loss, and yet the life and the legacy she continues to live with today. So I think we all have a story. You, my friend, have a beautiful story as well. Are there any other questions? Yes. Would you stand up and introduce yourself, Ms. Maureen? We'll need a microphone. Hold on. We're running over to you. Give Maureen a big hand, please. And before she speaks, this is the mean lady who stretched my joints as a physical therapist. And one of the mighty reasons that I run around on this stage and chase after kids and have an incredible life. So, Maureen, I give you a big hand, too. Thank you.
For a long time, I came to your house every Saturday and Sunday. And when I left, I would sit in my car and cry because I hated that I hurt you. I asked you one of the first times I came, what do you want to do? What can't you do right now that you want to do? Do you remember what you told me?
No.
You wanted to ride a bike.
You wanted to ride a bike? Yes.
Your parents got you a new bike.
Yes.
And I got a wind trainer that we could, so you could ride the bike in the house. And I bought that wind trainer over, and we put the bike on the wind trainer. And you said, well, not yet. But you did it. Your dad helped me, and we put you on that bike. And your legs started moving. And you sent me a picture of the first day that you rode a bike. I still have that picture in the book that your mom and dad gave me that they wrote. And so I don't really have a question.
No one does.
I just wanted to say I'm sorry for all those days that I hurt you. I have always loved you, and you will always be my hero.
As we're looking for someone over here and a microphone, I'd like to share just real quickly on in a Marine. It's very easy to do therapy for someone else, except it's extraordinarily difficult to do it well. It's probably true for parenting and everything else in life. Most therapists would come in and they would do something and I would say, that hurts, and they would stop. This lady would crank through the pain. And look, I do this naturally these days. I just kind of come down to get eye level with the audience, but it's Maureen, and it's a whole lot of other incredible therapists like her. So thank you for the donuts, and thank you for the legs. I'm grateful. A big hand for my friend Sissy, please.
Good evening. My name is Sissy Condit, and I had the good fortune of working, well, it was good fortune. I was working at the hospital when John was injured. And the first person I met was John walking into the emergency room. And Dr. Vajan and Tom Vitale, two of the doctors, were standing at the bedside. And I was head nurse of the burn center at that time. And I came into the emergency room and I saw John. And we could tell, we looked at each other. We would look at from doctor to nurse with our eyes just shocked. And then we'd look at John and try to change our expressions. And then Denny walked in, or came in, busted in, I should say, into the emergency room. And then John went up to the unit, and then Susan came. And I walked up to the unit with your parents, and talking about how lives changed. You changed my life, John, to be the person I am, to have a wonderful daughter, but to grow and love the O'Learys. It's been the most beautiful expression of sincere friendship. I'd have to say that the burn unit was the best of times and worst of times, but it was really a fun experience. Some days Susan will probably tell you the Mr. Piggy story. I won't bring that up right now, but that was very funny. But a funny story with Gino Cavalini, and I'll just tell you this very quickly. That bunny, one night we put that bunny in a patient bed and pretended, I happened to be working, so I thought we could take this sort of, you know, moment of fun. And it was a change of shift, and the bunny was in the bed as a patient. And I was telling the nurse coming on, she didn't know, you know, I said his last name was Rabbit. And she was taking all this down in report. And I said, you know, the strangest thing, he has a blue color. We're not really sure. And he's in the burn unit, probably needing plastic surgery on his ears. Because she was taking all that, you had to be there, perhaps. It was one of the funniest moments. And I mean, this is an intensive care unit. And we walked in, and I'll never forget how she, you know, the lights were low. And you know, when the sheet was completely over the bunny, and it really was 7 feet long, it was huge. It was so funny. And one of many, many funny times. But you were the best patient, and I love you so much.
Thank you. About two more questions, and then we're going to move forward. So one big question in the back. Yes, please.
Oh, hi. It's Dan Duffy. And
big hand for Dan Duffy.
I wanted to share this story with everybody because it's amazing. In 1987, when my brother and I were finally old enough to where we could be left at home alone and not destroy the place, my mom actually went to volunteer at St. John's. And I'll never forget, she came home one night and she was shattered. And I said, what's wrong? And she said, I met a boy who's going to die today. And what my mom did when she volunteered at St. John's was she used to work with like a lot of the preemies, and she used to feed them. And before the term was popular, she would have been considered a baby whisperer. And she told me about this little boy who was in a bed, and a nurse had come up to her and said, can you help feed him? Because he needs to survive, and he needs to eat, and he can't feed himself. And that day, 29 years ago, my mother met you. And my mother has never been wrong about anything except for this. And I just wanted you to stand up really quick, because this is the first time in 29 years that my mother has laid eyes on you since she saw you in that bed.
Thank you, Mrs. Duffy. Yes. Yes, okay, now. Big hand, please. All the way from Washington. Hold on. I know they're running a better microphone, so give Abby 2 seconds, and she'll hand you one that we can all hear.
I'm so nervous, I probably didn't press the right button. I'm sorry. But Ron Cowan and my wife, Jane, from Washington, Missouri. I worked for A.G. Edwards many years ago and still do, their successor, Wells Fargo. And I think I heard you probably fairly early on in your career. What an inspiration. I went back to Washington. I told every soul that I could find about this kid that was so inspirational, and you had to hear his story. We invited you out to Washington. I'm sure you remember that probably, and we had a great time, and many lives were touched. We've heard a lot of motivational speakers, of course, in the financial industry. You are the greatest, believe me. And thank you for all that, for inspiring lives in many ways other than just motivating us to do the right thing for our clients. But thank you for that. Just want very quickly, you had Joe Buck introduce you tonight. I can't help but think that we'd like to hear just one more time a little tidbit about Jack. And if I remember, this is what I always told people. Kid, if you want another autograph, write a thank you letter.
Dude, that was good. We'd go on the road with that. So thank you, Ron. And Jack Buck was so instrumental. And so I'd be honored to share a little bit of his story, a little bit of the background on how he learned, and then share kind of a concluding story. And then we are all going to walk out of here on fire for our lives, not O'Leary's life, not Gino's life, not Maureen's life, not Dan's life, but our lives. That's the story I want to make sure we celebrate in this room. But if getting Jack's story up there helps do that, I'm delighted to. The day after I was burned, I am laying in darkness. So I'm going to turn this screen off. And my arms are tied down to the bed. I can't move. They have me on a trach, which means I can't breathe on my own. I can't eat or drink. I can't talk. And like you see tonight, the lights are out. I can't see anything. And the only thing I could really do is feel pain and struggle and wonder why, pray, dream, and listen. When your eyes are shut, you hear actually much better. Some of you are living proof of that tonight. So I appreciate the intensity with which you are listening. So I just spent all this time as a little guy, tied down, unable to do a thing, and into my room the day after I'm burned comes the greatest announcer, I think, ever, certainly in this region. Jack Buck, my boyhood hero, walks in, sits down. It's a scary situation. Grab Sissy later on and ask her, what's it like at a burn center? It's terrifying. It's terrifying. It's horrible. And this guy walks into the unknown. He suits up, sits down, and like you said so beautifully, he says, kid, wake up. You are going to live. You are going to survive. Keep fighting. John O'Leary Day at the ballpark will make it all worthwhile. And then he says, kid, are you listening? And then the old announcer says back, good, keep fighting. And then he walks up. He leaves me tied down in darkness by myself. Absolutely fired up. One visit changed my world, and I learned later on that after he left, he was told by the staff that the little boy was going to die. It's a hopeless situation. He's done his good deed. He went by the hospital. He's done his thing. And the following day, a little boy who is going to die, apparently, is laying there on the cliff of death, dying. And then the door opens up, and somebody walks in. I hear the footsteps, the chair, the cough. And then I hear Jack's voice. Kid, wake up. I'm back. You are going to live. Keep fighting. John O'Leary Day at the ballpark will make it all worthwhile. Those visits went on the 5 months that I was in hospital. This is a guy, and you'll have to read about it in chapter 7 if you get that far, who taught me how to write. And it is a compelling story of servant leadership, of love, of the we that we celebrate in this room. I didn't teach myself how to write. I could have never done it. But with Jack's help and with the therapist's help and with my family's help, yeah, we wrote again. And eventually, later on in life, he stayed my friend. We remained buddies. When I graduated university, Jack Buck presented me the baseball that he received when he went into the Hall of Fame. It's made of crystal. It's priceless. The note read, kid, this means a lot to me. Hope it means a lot to you too. Enjoy, it's yours. Kid, this is the baseball I received when I went into Cooperstown. It's made of crystal. It is priceless. There is only one like it. Don't drop it. And then all he wrote was, it's yours, comma, Jack. That was the note. That was as grandiose as it got. So this guy just served this little boy. He changed my life. It's the power of love and the power of one person pouring into another. Gino's another example. We all are examples, though. And I'd like to kind of bring us full tilt back to one of the great things in my life that I get to celebrate. If this baby will work, maybe it won't. Guys, advance one slide if you don't mind. Perfect. Here we go. One of the concerns I always had as a little boy, after I learned how to ride a bike, after I learned how to ride again, after I was able to go back to grade school, and I know a lot of my buddies from St. Clements are here tonight, after I went on to high school, one of the great concerns I always had was, what little girl will ever want to take the hand of a little boy that doesn't have fingers? Well, what kind of little girl? Who would ever do that? I would. Well, if you're available, write down your name and number on a card and just quietly put it in my pocket on your way out. That's true for all of us. But I never knew. I never knew what she would look like. I never knew when it would show up. I had a lot of great girlfriends. I know some of them are even here today. But I never dated any of them. And then in college, I met a girl that I did fall in love with right away. She clearly fell deeply in love with me right away. Okay. She jumped on my back. She's remained there ever since. We have this great love story. I give her cool gifts, like El Caminos. She likes them, okay? I give her gifts that she's not as wild about, like dogs for Valentine's Day, okay? She doesn't like dogs. But we have an incredible life together because she was bold enough and courageous enough to see past scars, which a lot of ladies and a lot of men would never have been able to do. To get past what is so obvious, to move through that, and to see what's actually there. So I am extremely blessed to have found Beth, to have fallen in love with her, to have her fall back in love with me. I fell in love with her the first night we started hanging out. I stalked her for a year. Before finally building up the courage to actually ask her out. And I remember, we were out. I laid my heart on the table. I told her exactly how I felt. And then she said back to me, John, you are like a brother to me. Which I then said, I already have four sisters. I don't need a fifth, okay? But that didn't work. So she's rejected me, another rejection, more failure. I wonder if it's my hands or my scars, or I wonder what it is. Why can't I find this thing? And then another year passes. I'm still hot in pursuit of Elizabeth Grace. And I ask her out again. I take this big, bold chance. I laid it out perfectly this time, did a lot of prep work on the delivery. And then finally she said back, yes, yes. But that's not what she said. John, you're like a brother to me. Nothing's changed. Nothing's changed. Which stuck. And then one of the great lessons in my life came about, which was to finally, sometimes, when you keep pursuing things for your end, you're setting yourself up for failure. When I was finally bold enough and faithful enough to hold this thing with my hands wide open, to not pursue Beth, but just to love her for who she was and the relationship we currently had, for everything that came out of that, not looking for a girlfriend anymore, but enjoying a wonderful girl that happened to be my friend. It changed. I changed, she changed, eventually we changed. We were at dinner, sitting outside at Cafe Napoli. About halfway through dinner, she starts gulping wine. She puts the glass down and she says to me, John, every time I'm with you now, I get butterflies in my stomach. I wish they would fly away. But John, I'm realizing now that I've fallen for you. And then she said, will you date me? And I said, I don't date sisters. That's gross. But then instead of speaking those words, I drooled out the word yes. Yes. We have dated maybe 3 years. We've been married 14 or so. It's the best decision I ever made to pursue her and then to let go of that pursuit and just love her for who she was and then finally to say yes when it came back into my life. Yes, yes. It led to this picture, which led eventually into this picture. In very short order. The honeymoon was short, okay? And so right now with the lights down dark, I would like you to bring them up just a little bit more so I can celebrate my beautiful wife. Her name is Elizabeth Grace. We call her Beth. Beth, please stand up. And I'm going to make my kids all stand up. I know they're excited about this. So Jack, my oldest, named after Jack Buck. Patrick. Stand up, Patrick. Henry, get up, man. And Grace, would you stand up? And in a moment, if you've not had your name called yet, you're one of the three that I've not single-handedly pointed out. You will stand up too. So get ready for that. But before we get there, I want to read you something from my book. I know this is like a book reading. The only thing is I don't really like to read aloud. So instead, I'm going to read you probably the shortest passage in the entire book. It's on fire. There are copies available in the back and online. It's a message that we're trying to share with the world. Say again. It's a paid endorsement, but I still appreciate it. Once you stop reading it, you cannot stop. And I agree because it's not about the writer. It's not about the author. It's not about the little guy who got burned. It's about the stories that he realizes through a tragedy. And what we can do through our lives, whether you're a 25-year-old hockey player or a 79-year-old announcer with Parkinson's disease, that we can do more and that we are better than what we've been doing to this point. And that's inspiring to me. I think it's inspiring to all of us. I want to read my dedication. To my wife, Beth, The night we met, you had the courage to take my hand, and we danced. That's right. We've danced together through friendship, dating, marriage, parenting, challenges. Those two go hand in hand, I think. Parenting, challenges, joys, and life ever since. Thank you, Beth, for being a constant encouragement, a wonderful mother, an awesome wife, and my best friend. I love you. So the question I hope you're asking right now is, what song was it? What'd you dance to, man? What'd you dance to? We dance that night. We dance every time we hear it at Humphrey's. We dance to it on our wedding night. When Beth and I are in the kitchen at night doing dishes, if this song comes on, we can't help but dance. And so tonight, I was trying to think, what's the best way to wrap up this celebration? Clearly having the bars open will help, so that will happen in about 5 minutes. But I've always found, if you have one person speaking, it gets a little bit boring. If you have just Mike Mattingly over here singing at us, it gets a little bit boring. But when we decide to play along, when we decide to participate, when we decide to re-engage in life, it's exciting. It's good again. It is good again to be all in. So in a moment, my 1,000 family and friends, I'd like you to come to your feet, like Joe encouraged you to on the front side of the presentation. And this time, rather than clapping, we're going to be singing. And the song that we are going to sing with Mr. Mike's help is a song by Neil Diamond called Sweet Caroline. So what I'd like you all to do is to slowly come to your feet. Oh, stretch those vocal cords. I can already hear the excitement. Mike, can you hear the excitement?
I can.
Is everybody up and ready to go? Can we hear it one time for Mr. John Lord?
Don't seem so lonely. We only love the thorn.